Because I don't know whether it's only me that has not understood most of the things, so it's not yet at my level. But anyway, I have a question which is related to this. I don't know whether I understand these two concepts, niche range and niche shift. I'm asking this in relation to the organisms that I'm studying, the fruit flies. Not long ago, I read some publication, it's on the fruit flies. The title was as simple as fruit flies at boiling point. And the conclusion from this study was that fruit flies will be managed by climate change because they don't seem to have the ability to evolve their niche. I don't know if it's related to this because the question comes to why are we managing if they are going to die tomorrow? So I don't know whether niche shifts are specific to natural species, because in the same article you were saying that humans can kind of evolve, and I need to understand that some species can evolve faster than others, and specifically the environmental jacket formed by fruit flies, they were saying it will not allow them to evolve over time.
So, I think we have to think about reasons for evolution and reasons for non-evolution. If fruit flies lack genetic variation for the sorts of environmental responses that they're talking about, then they simply may not have the potential to respond, even if the environment changes. Okay? Other reasons for non-evolution may be stabilizing selection, which is to say there are selective pressures keeping the phenotype, which in this case is response to environment, keeping the phenotype where it is. And another reason for non-evolution is non-selection, which is to say, imagine a species that has very broad environmental tolerance, and at a given site or a given population or even in a given species range, the environmental range may be all suitable to the species. And so in that sense, there's no selection inserted in the species. So in any of these cases, we can have a situation where the niche is able to or not. Evolutionarily to track in terms of your tolerances. going to die out from those changes, essentially move that site outside the species from the image. Okay.
So Tom, this game, are you potentially one of the niche of plant species does not have an effect on speciation. What I'm saying is, there's a particular plant which has in Africa it has two species. Now, one of the species in East Africa is quite different from the one in West Africa. And the reason they gave was the uplift of the Tanzanian uplift, making it different. So the speciation happened at that point. So, and possibly it means that the niche must have changed. That's why it was able to speciate. So I want to go, because what you're trying to tell us here is that speciation does not really affect, I mean, a niche does not really affect speciation.
It actually may be quite to the contrary. If a species has a constant, unchanging niche over a particular time span, and if environments change such that a gap appears in the species' potential distribution, then that might be exactly the agent of speciation, which is to say, a vicariate event. Okay? So a constant niche doesn't mean a connected distribution. Think about the Amazon Pleistocene Refuge hypothesis. The idea is that those humid forest environments went from very entire and warm periods to very fragmented and cool periods. If a species has a niche that is constant and that requires those humid conditions, then its populations may have been fragmented as well. So I think in that sense, constant versus variable niche is not very well related to speciation. In fact, a niche that evolves easily is probably less likely to see a vicariate event caused by fungi. Okay? Now, let's go back to the example you gave of this two species lineage. One is in the highlands, one is in the lowlands. Okay. How old is the split, approximately? Let's imagine it's old.
Yeah.
Okay. Because the eastern species apparently was uplifted with the highlands. A series of complications with that inference. One is that just the fact that they have different niches and they're different species doesn't mean that the difference in niche evolved as a consequence of the speciation event. It could easily have evolved subsequently. And second of all, it's surprisingly frequently that you look at two forms and you say those two niches are different. But you have to ask the question a little differently. You have to ask the question, you see those two clouds of points, maybe looking at the environmental space, you see they're very different. But the question is the set of conditions represented within M for each of those species. Which is to say, the two clouds may be different simply because the two M's are different. So let me give you an example. Imagine a fairly broadly niched species. It can deal with anything from Arctic to Equatorial, right? It can survive. And you do your study in Greenland, and you say, look at its niche. And you do your study in Kenya, and you say, look at its niche. And they're not overlapped. But that population is restricted to Greenland only experiences Greenland climates and never experiences Kenyan climates. So until you see the Greenland population respond to Kenyan climates and vice versa, you really can't conclude niche difference. That's an extreme example. But imagine if through sexual selection or some other selective pressure, imagine those two separate populations, one of them evolves a redhead and the other one evolves a bluehead. Sorry, you're a plant. One of them has a red flower and the other one has a blue flower. So you're going to call them different species. You still have the same image. Okay? And you still can't establish whether it's the same niche or not, because you never see the populations of one species within the background of the other species. Now, if the animals were overlapping in environmental space, maybe we have one species in Kenya and one species in Tanzania. Well, those animals environmentally are going to overlap quite broadly. And because, you know, they're fairly similar in the two countries in terms of climate. So then, essentially what we're doing with those background similarity tests, I didn't mention a critical feature of them, is that they require a hypothesis of N for each species. And so essentially what you're asking is, how frequently does species A experience the environments used by species B and not survive or not establish populations? That is direct evidence for niche. Okay? So it has to be within the M for A and within the N for B. Okay? Other questions?
From the biological concept,
okay,
or from the ecological concept, or from the phylogenetic concept. So it doesn't have one particular name.
Okay. You mentioned one that I want to leave out. Okay? The ecological speciation. That's actually not a definition of species,
yeah,
but rather a definition of process. But the biological species concept is defining separate lineage by lack of gene flow. And the evolutionary species concept just says separate evolutionary trajectories. And the phylogenetic species concept says diagnosable differences. But all of those are, in some sense, an index of evolutionary independence of the lineages. But leave out the ecological speciation, because that's a process. That's how you get the interruption of gene flow, not that you have gotten the interruption of gene flow. So, coming back to your question, what I'm arguing is that basically everything can take place. In theory, you can have a species adapt to an ecological gradient and then interrupt gene flow so that those adaptations are preserved. What I'm saying is, we don't see that very often. Okay? This goes back to the parapatric speciation processes that were explored in the 70s and 80s by John Henley. With atmosphere again. Let's think about the Pleistocene. It's warm now and it's cool, warm, cool, warm, cool. Well, all of that had pretty serious implications for distributions of climates and, as a consequence, distributions of species. So we talk about the Dahomey Gap, right? The Dahomey Gap is a dry break in humid habitats in extreme western Africa versus western and central Africa. Well, that gap apparently expanded and contracted during the Pleistocene. At times it was wider, at times it was very narrow. And all I'm saying is that a species with a constant niche may have the opportunity to get across the gap when it's narrow, and then be isolated when it's wide. Okay? So, in many ways, niche and distribution are quite independent. We really can't predict how niche will respond to environmental change from how distribution responded. But in all of these cases, once you interrupt gene flow, right, it could be by many means, but once you interrupt gene flow, then you have two separately evolving populations, and either or both of them may evolve in response to their environment. And so you have the potential for niche change. My only argument is that in the species that have been looked at in these terms, in coarse-grained environmental terms, there is no strong signal that niche change and speciation go together. They both can happen, but there's no strong evidence that they happen together. Okay? So it's a difficult argument, and there are people who can give me a tough one.
Can the change of the niche or the ego can affect the gene?
Yes, we have a
doubt. If it can affect the gene, meaning that you don't have a situation. Because at the end of the day, if you do not have the same gene flow, meaning that you cannot begin to come back. And meaning that they are not a situation. Because by the moment of the people, you know that the species will break. So that's inflow interruption or exit. I don't want to call it interruption. I just affect.
Without a doubt.
Yeah.
So for example, in the Amazon, as Pleistocene glaciations and cooling events happen, we had once continuous forest across the Amazon, basically from the Andes to the Atlantic Ocean. And as the globe cooled, those humid forest patches apparently retracted into little islands. So that's environmental change definitely interrupting gene flow amongst populations that live in the forest. Okay? Now, a different thing is niche change. And clearly, niche change, were it to occur, can affect distributional potential. That's everything we've been talking about this week. And if it affects distributional potential so as to fragment populations, then you've affected gene flow. Okay? The mechanism by which that can happen in a continuous population is pretty hard to come up with. And again, that takes us back to these parapactic speciation models that were explored in the 70s and 80s. They saw a lot of attention and they saw very little empirical support. So that's a challenging set of work to find strong empirical support for. I'll speak in terms of purpose. That's the realm that I know of. Okay? But at least in vertebrates, you don't see much evidence for people to choose. Okay.
Thank you. In coexisting systems, where several species occur in the same location, is it possible to use the ecological niche model analysis to assess how the high density
possible, yes, easy, no. Essentially what we're doing is we're getting quite far up to the right on that equation. Remember we had, after we had gotten the existing fundamental mesh, we got out to the realized mesh. And the realized mesh was the existing fundamental mesh as reduced by B. Okay? And B is the effect of perhaps that high density species. That interaction have geographic implications, geographic manifestations. I've been involved in one study that made a pretty convincing demonstration of that by Anderson colleagues in 2002 or 2003. But it was kind of an unusual situation. More frequently, what we would be doing, given that they're coexisting, more frequently we measure their populations and looking for consistent population responses is one of the other. But if they're coexisting, then the geography ends up being different. So these are things where maybe we could ask questions about which species is kind of more centrally located within this ecological template. I'd recommend to you a paper that Enrique just read on essentially predicting abundances based on niche centrality. It's a very interesting paper, very interesting idea. Is that in your packet, the biology letters paper?
No.
No? Okay, we'll get it to you all. But it's essentially dealing with how abundance relates to centrality or peripherality in the niche. Difficult analysis, interesting, but it might be relevant. Now, one thing I've said to a bunch of you is that it's not just doing these analyses that makes them interesting or publishable. It's doing them within the framework of a useful, insightful set of questions. So you pose the question, and then you figure out which tools are the most relevant to that question. And in at least one case, my answer was very clearly, this is not a niche modeling question. This is a question for other tools. Okay? So for example, in your case, you may be looking at a time series of abundances. When that high density species goes up, does the other species respond by going down? And that's not a spatial phenomenon, that's a population. Okay? So always come at science with the question leading you along. And that question then takes you to what are the techniques that I should be using. And the techniques hopefully give you a clear answer to your question.